think there, it's not underserviced. I don't think there's very much intention to service, you know. I mean, there is an organization called the South African Book Development Council, which was supposed to look in SA at developing book publishing in the country, you know, and that organization recently closed down, so, or was, you know, discontinued. And so when I look at it, I'm like, you know, I think there's a saying that goes that the person who can't read is, or the person who doesn't read a book is no different to the person who can't read, you know. And I think that's kind of like the thing I thought about is like, if somebody, if you don't want to read, you know, if there's no desire, there's no enthusiasm, then there's, I mean, you could put the meaning to life in a book, and if no one has a desire to read it, they won't read it. And so it became one of those things that I meditated on. I was like, you know what, I think somebody has to kind of go in that space and either be an ambassador or a vehicle or a tool to research it, collect information. Whatever needs to be done, I need to get in there and do it, you know. And so right now, obviously, we've got our first issue, but we're looking forward and saying, you know, Marvel wasn't built in a day, right? Stan Lee's family, it's a family, Marvel's a family-run organization that was purchased, you know, by a corporate. So it made me think that you can start a family business, you know, publishing, and then build a relationship with an animation house, build a relationship with film. It's going to take time, but I believe that will be an African property, you know. I'm also self-taught as a comic book writer, so it also said to me, I can teach the next person. You know, if you can write a rap song, you can create a comic book character, you know. And it motivated me to say, how many young African children, if you said, hey, let's write a rap song, they'll jump on, they'll write the verses. But you're like, hey, let's create a comic book character. Hey, whoa, you know? So I looked at it, I'm like, you know what? You need the first guy to take that leap, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm been somebody who everything that I've wanted to do, I did. I wanted to break dance, I did it. I wanted to rap, I did it. I wanted to go into comic books, I did it, you know? And I realized sometimes you're given certain qualities that the next person might not have. Somebody's adventurous, the next person is a bit more conservative, you know? So sometimes you have to be the evangelist that goes to the platform, gets the information, and brings it back. And so I see Rainbow Nation Comics fulfilling a lot of roles. I mean, if you're going to be a startup, you have to be the client liaison officer. I'm heading publishing. I'm doing editing, you know, all of those responsibilities. And so my vision was then to say, South Africa doesn't have this publishing house. I want to volunteer myself as that entity. And then I'm willing to do all the steps that it takes to learn. So I'm willing to engage with animators and be like, hey, this is where we want young Nelson to go. I'm willing to engage with filmmakers and go in that direction. So I think a lot of the activities we will fulfill will either be co-productions or, you know, licensing of our IP, you know. And so at this moment, with the context of the collapse of the Book Development Council, and I think South Africa is unique with our history. You know, I believe literacy was never a priority for African children in our country. So the challenge then becomes, if we're looking to create an animation world, an animated world, a film world, you need source material. So where are you going to source your material? You're going to look for books to source from. And so I realized there's this weird dynamic where we're trying to, we've put the cart before the horse. We're trying to create an animation world when there's no source material. So I also thought, either way, whether we go into public domain and we just reinvent the Cinderella story, reinvent Snow White, there's a lot of ways you can go about it, but I've realized that at the end of the day, there needs to be a serious focus on the creation of comic books that are African, that are authentic, that are for, and there needs to be almost like an experimental phase where you're not saying, I want to make profits. You're actually listening to your audience, because sometimes, like, if you just want to make money tomorrow, you can sell a lot of comics to people who already have money, because you know the dynamics of our country. People who are already consuming comic books can make you more money. But if you're saying you want to change the consciousness of people who haven't read before and have them read, you need to listen to them. You need to listen. If they want a superhero who can show you how to start your business, or if they, whatever they want, you need to service them. So, yeah, with the resources that we have, we're looking to kind of get feedback at the moment and kind of compile a series of, like, a catalog of heroes that African, South African audiences would want. And as income comes in, then to, you know, release funds in that way. We're also looking, you know, in the near future, or in the future, we want to actually have grants for African publishing, you know. We need South African, we've got a deficit of African writers, and I'm saying we need to have a situation where an African kid who comes up with a story isn't thinking, where am I? He knows, if this story is good enough, all I need to do is get into this platform, submit everything I need to submit, and I've got what it takes to produce the story. You know, and I think something like Canix is actually awesome because if you have a situation where, let's say, I'm a comic book writer, somebody's doing animation in Kenya, somebody, you know, like Lydia, we can then find a way where we can say, you know what, let's create a curriculum or create a quality control system to know this kid is good enough to get publishing, this kid still needs some work. And once we've got that system in place, I think it's going to make it an industry because it's going to grow by itself exponentially. Because if you've got 500 comic book writers, you bring in the animators, you have a festival where you bring in the film guys, they look at the titles, then they're like, hey, I want to work with you on this one, you know? And the other thing is that we're creator-owned. So we're looking at saying the only IP we have in-house is IP we created ourselves. That's the only IP we're going to kind of put our name on it, we're going to own as Rainbow Nation Comics. Any IP that somebody brings to Rainbow Nation Comics is like, hey, I want to get publishing or I want to get distribution and marketing. We would obviously look at the overheads and make sure that that guy gets out there. Because I feel like the other challenge, the great thing about America might also be its weakness in that, you know, when you look at Marvel and DC, I feel like they've been bottlenecked with IP. You know, they've got 10,000 IP products each, but there's not enough creatives to be like, hey, you do that, you do that. You know, and there's also a different way you create content when it's your own story. When there's already like, okay, this character can't do this, 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 and this. Oh, yeah, then create the character. Then you can only create what the team that came before you did. So, yeah, I think our goal is to be a hub for African content creators in the animation space. Where we are now is in the experimental phase. We are still getting feedback from audiences, from our audiences to say, what are you looking into?
Building momentum.
Yeah.
And expanding.
Yeah, comic books that I sell, it's honestly face-to-face. We've been to Comic-Con. We've sold at Comic-Con about plus minus 400 comic books. And so, yeah, festivals, we'd engage, sell. Obviously, we recently went in bookstores. So in about 6 months, I'll know how we're doing in terms of sales. Okay. At the same time, I know that we will need marketing. You know, in order to get your book in people's faces, I believe that you need to kind of consistently put it in someone's face every day, every week, every month. So that marketing is also something that we're looking at to say, how do you fund a marketing marketing
campaign.
Or publishing?
Yeah.
You know? So yeah, I think our main challenge now is really the mentality of our readers, right? Because what I've noticed is, you know, we never act inconsistently with the people we believe ourselves to be, right? So if we as African don't believe that we are a reading nation, if we don't believe that we are a prolific, voracious reading nation, right, then we act consistent with who we believe we are. So we'll read newspapers that don't have much. It's literally just entertainment. It's gossip. It's, you know. So I think it requires that we message long enough that the African child can believe that they are, you know, academic, that they are, you know, able to embrace new ideas, that they can get into this space and not be criticized. Yeah.
Thanks, Pamela. I agree with your statements there. I think it's important that, or put it this way, it's really difficult to be a pioneer on that industry. So I'm sure everyone will be keeping their eyes on what happens with young Nelson. Lydia. Naoto Studios is a fairly new studio, but with your aspirations of creating content for modern media experiences such as animation, video games, and VR and AR, have you considered how you will generate revenue in the short, medium, and long term?
Ah, yes. Well, I can give a breakdown of how Naoto Studios operates as it is. So let's have a quick math session. Let's take our third most recent project. Kenya recently had some by-elections in Emali, which were held by the election board. They commissioned us to go study it, collect data, and use, and what we get, we develop learning kit, a media kit, for next year's main elections. From that, let's take $1,000 USD from that one. That 1,000 will take 65% for personnel upkeep and other studio costs, because animation is very intensive. 5% will go into overheads, and the remaining 35% will go into developing our own intellectual properties. That's usually how we break down everything. A majority goes into keeping us alive, 5% goes into keeping the studio alive, and 30% goes into creating our own content, because now the studio's main goal is to become our own type, is to rival Disney. What we want to do is be able to thrive off of our own intellectual property. So yeah, that's basically pretty much the breakdown. I could go into how we are collecting data for that, collecting cash for that.
I think it's going to vary from company to company what their strategy is, but it's interesting that you at least have a strategy at this early stage. So I'll get your thoughts on that. Let's talk about capacity, and I'll kind of open this up to either of you. One of the things that is most challenging, I think, at the moment in Africa is capacity. But then if we have that capacity, we also don't have access to our own market at the moment. So let's first talk about capacity. What are some of the challenges for Naoto Studios to grow and expand to where you see it in the near future? What are those?
The main challenge we face is getting more personnel. How we decided to fix that is Naoto Studios has an internship program where for 6 months, paid of course, because I've been a college student and we know the hustle, for 6 months you shall come with us, develop your own concept, and in turn, during those 6 months, you will help us with our own projects. That usually gives us access to a pool of enthusiastic and trainable people. Let me just generalize it and say people. Who are willing to put in time and give us their time and put in some effort to help us create our own content. And by the time they are done with their session, they have a concept ready that they can use to market themselves out there. Or if they want to remain with us, they can stay with us. Their choice is theirs. That's how we usually handle the personnel issue. Another issue that we typically face is funding. Funding affects everyone. That's why we actually had to create that breakdown so that we can at least negate the main issue. But still, it's still an existing problem for almost every upcoming studio. So as we decided to go about it in three ways. For funding, the first and most obvious route that a majority of everyone will take is crowdfunding. We opened a crowdfunding page with ThunderFund, which is based in South Africa. It's still ongoing if you want to. There's lots of goodies for those who pledge. The second option was getting publishers, which we have signed a bit. And the third option is just putting in the work. It'll take just putting in the work and hoping for the best. That's the one that takes the longest, and it's what we had been doing, but I assure you, you're going to take like 4 to 6 years to get a project done that could have been done in two.
So what I'm getting out of that is a lot of the potential can be unlocked with investment, early investment.
Yes.
Startup capital, seed funding, would accelerate expansion of Naoto Studios.
Yeah, if we could actually get more capital, we could expand from a studio of 15 to maybe, let's say, 45. With that, we could actually have all our projects out within the next 2 years. But if we go at this rate, it shall be 3 years. So, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Pamelo, you were discussing that you're now distributing into traditional bookstores. There's an interesting parallel to the broadcast industry in Africa, which is predominantly owned at a pan-African level in terms of pay TV operators by international media companies, many of which don't necessarily have any investment in Africa. Some of them do, but the challenge for us as an African production industry is to rival the license fees that are paid by, or at least the license fees that are paid for the catalogs of content that these international media companies own, and we cannot compete at a rate that would allow us to have a sustainable industry. You've gone about it in terms of your comic book distribution and self-publishing. Is there, in your opinion, some parallel to the broadcast industry in self-broadcasting?
So I guess what you're saying is there a parallel between broadcasting and self-broadcasting as well as self-publishing and traditional publishing?
Correct.
I would say, in essence, yes. I mean, I think in a way, broadcasting is publishing because you're putting your art in your work out into the public, and obviously you're looking to get compensated for it. So, because from a communications background, all of these are just communication media platforms. So publishing is just one. It's like if I'm trying to get a message across, I could get it through in a book, I could get it through in a movie, I could get it through in a television series. So I see publishing as only just one extension of the bigger
storytelling.
Yeah. So I think one of the things I think about more and more is, like, you know, international broadcasters would never be allowed to produce a message that is contrary to what the government of that organization comes from.
Yeah.
So if you're from America, you will not be allowed to publish a movie that promotes communism, you know. And my thing is, like, I'm always like, why is it that at least African leaders, African, don't come together and say, okay, cool, you can publish here, but we have certain recommendations. First of all, this is how you should not depict black people. You can't do it like this. We go through it. You can get psychologists and find out what are the effects of negative imaging of black people. Make sure you look at that. Number two, have a system to say, okay, this is how many African people need to be involved in these sectors of this publishing. Because I feel like the challenge becomes, it's almost like now we're trying to reinvent the wheel, you know, in order to then create content where you could potentially collaborate with international media and say, look, culturally, this is who we are. You know, bring in enough people from that specific culture that you're bringing in to elaborate what certain symbols mean. Because certain symbols that are just neutral in one culture are offensive in another. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think sometimes you see that as an African in a movie, like, wait, why did they put that there? You know, but there's no mechanism to actually be like, hey, that's, you know,
offensive.
Yeah.
Or non-offensive.
Yeah.
I agree. I think, and the reason why I ask this question is because it's a catch-22. So you've now made this investment into Naoto Studios. They've got 45 animators. They're churning our content, but now they can't access an audience because they cannot compete against international media companies. And it's something that we at the African Animation Network have been, you know, investigating quite extensively and researching how we can access audience that a critical mass of all these studios and these content producers to become self-sustaining, and that helps build this industry that we talk about. So we've got all the talent in the world. You know, they're getting snapped up by Disney and Cartoon Network and all of these international media companies, but it's, in my opinion, it's anomalous because you've just got, you know, a handful of exceptional talent that's been picked up and moving on to international productions. We're not producing here in Africa significantly enough.
And I think the interesting thing is that I'm not the first comic book creator in South Africa, right? There's a lot of guys that actually go to the U.S., guys that are, the guy who could be an editor in SA of a comic book publishing house, who then leaves and does maybe promotional artwork or just what he can find in this huge
industry, yeah, you know, global industry.
Yeah, and I think for me, I'm like, as artists, all we can do is continue to create art, maybe advocate for the importance of why we collaborate and show the importance of it. But I think I think there's an important dynamic when you create superheroes, because like I told you with the Pantheon theory, if you've got heroes in your mind that shape your decisions, I felt that the negative of that is if you don't have heroes, or if you have heroes that are destructive, that you also become a destructive individual. You know, I always think of, like, maybe in unprivileged backgrounds when kids look at gangsters as their heroes, because that's the guy you see every single day.
Well, because he's the guy that's succeeding.
Yeah, and I think for me, that's the thing, is like an African child, when you come from a community, you know what symbols to juxtapose to change the psychology of a child. You might say, what if the gangster, instead of, you know, selling to the kid, says, hey, don't do what I did because I made bad decisions. You can, in a film, in an animation, in a story, know what to do, having come from that culture, to change perceptions. So I think there's a cultural shift that needs to take place where, because if we focus on profits and reaching targets, we can do that. We can, you know, I mean, Nauta Studios and Rainbow Nation Comics can license our work to the big guys in the US. We could, you know, get bought up and we will then be in awe, like, why is Africa not developing? But Africa develops when Africans stay on the continent, and whether we come together and collaborate with government to say, what is our, I don't know if it's a creatives charter or creatives, something that's legally binding to say, if
manifesto, maybe.
Yeah, if you're not co-producing with Nauta Studios or another studios, you can't shoot your movie. You can't be here.
Oh, yeah. So it's almost like a quota system.
Yeah, because...
I understand the point, but I'm also reluctant for us to... Because that can force businesses not to invest in our countries. It's a gray area, and it's probably a topic that we should discuss in another panel discussion. Can I ask you to introduce yourself, please, and keep your question quite quick? We've only got a short period of time.
Right. Thank you so much. My name is Nomfundo Klaba from Bobby Roy. Thank you so much to our panelists. My question goes out to Lydia specifically. Just in terms of preserving, and I know you mentioned that you use motion sensors to sort of capture the movement. Those type of technologies and access to them, how easy is it? Are they readily available, especially in your field? And have you experienced difficulty in finding the precise programs for the quality of animation you want to bring?
Thank you for that question. Actually, I was hoping I could talk about this. There's a joke that runs in Nauta Studios that the equipment costs the same as it. The equipment is not expensive. It's bringing it in that's expensive. We could literally, what do they call it? Shipping fees. Sometimes the shipping fees actually match the cost of the actual product, and we're usually left there like, okay, it's genuinely cheaper for one of us to go over there, buy it, then just put it in our luggage and come back with it. Accessing tech is not easy. For Kawia, what we did was we created our own motion capture suit. And just hooked it up in a rig in Unreal Engine. So accessing the, but I can give you some advice if you want to access tech. Let's say a company like Google would be super interested in anything. They're usually super helpful. They're really interested in a majority of, if you need tech, they usually provide it. They've provided us with some of the computers we use. So yeah, is that a satisfactory answer or do you have any other?
There was a gentleman who had his hand up at the back here.
Thank you so much. My name is Brian from Nairobi. I just wanted to ask a question to both panelists. We have a huge issue in the continent where you have brain drain. A lot of the talent that you actually said it, a lot of the individuals working within the continent actually moving out of the continent. So according to your work, are there any sort of incentives or talent retention sort of frameworks that you guys are building around what you guys are currently doing? Thank you.
From my side, I would say we need to actually create a comic book publishing house, right? Have a premises where people can come and actually submit their ideas and produce content. Because first of all, if nobody's even giving you an email that says, sorry, you're not good enough or your work isn't good enough, you're not going to be inspired to actually create more content. So once you've got a premises where people can actually submit their work, I believe that's the first step. And the interesting thing was with Stan Lee said with Marvel is that he would sometimes even pay his employees less than other companies, but they would stay because of the work environment. As artists, the unique thing that you have as in Africa is that if we can provide for employees an opportunity that to work in a safe, in a conducive environment, whether they get a stipend so that they don't worry about finances and say, you know what, I'm barely cutting it even, I'm going to the US. Because it's not like an overnight thing. It takes time before somebody decides to leave the country. So I believe if, and maybe there's other creatives who can tell you specifically what they need, but I think we need an organization, a brick and mortar organization that people know this is the home of content creators for Africa.
Lydia?
Oh yeah, I can actually add to that. At our studio, to retain personnel, what we usually do is, while they're there, I can attest that people really like what we do. So while we're there, if they have a concept that they'd like to run through pre-production, we will give them our full support in at least developing it to a point that they can present it to our investor, which is actually why we usually have to filter out a lot of the people who apply to just take around 7, because we can work on 7 projects during your internship period. By the time you're done up with us, if you want to stay with us, well and good. If you want to leave and forge your own path, also okay. But most of us treat each other like family. We started out as 3 friends, me, Tabby, Debbie, and now we are 7 personnel, and I think that family thing has stuck. We still have it with everyone in studio, and we try to build up on that one. So as for brain drain, I'd rather, if you create an environment where people are happy and they don't want to, then they won't want to leave. I genuinely can't tell someone to stop if they think that they'll find greener pastures, because you came here alone, you'll die alone. Do you? It's your own life. Yeah, so if they want to leave, they can. But I'd like to create a place where they would like to stay.
Absolutely. Just to elaborate on that point, I think one of the major challenges for us in, and I think it's possibly not just the animation and comic books industry, but in the TV and broadcast space, is access to audience. We're actually launching a proof of concept kids program block in the first quarter of 2022 called Foopy Toons. So we run a kids film festival, and it's a short film festival. It's African shorts that we aggregate into approximately a 1-hour program block, which is plus minus the length of a feature film. And then pre-COVID, we used to tour it around the continent. Anyway, that was a long-winded way for me to say that we're branding this kids program block Foopy Toons, and we're going to be testing audience across Africa, in sub-Saharan Africa, hoping to reach between 85 and 120 million households. We think once we reach critical audience, a critical mass of audience, that we will be able to start matching the salaries that are being paid for our top talent to emigrate. So I think once we actually have a functional industry, we're gonna keep the best talent.
Hi, my name is Tegan Bristow. I'm from Wits University. It's very interesting to hear about your program and also about the question of capacity. I'm quite interested by the fact that the question of ownership seems to be one of the other things as well, like meeting your creative needs and being able to work in that way. The question I have, however, is for Nick, and I wanted to know, what are the hurdles? What is holding back publishing on the continent? What are some of the key things that you're looking at addressing in your program?
Comic book publishing or book?
I was thinking about comic books and animation, actually.
Okay, so comic books, if you actually look at Nigeria, they're booming. The comic book industry is actually the biggest on the continent. And it's really interesting because they also have the biggest film industry on the continent, and it's the third biggest in the world. I think it's the, in terms of the volume of films that they produce per year, it's actually bigger than Hollywood. But by revenue, they're arguably third in the world. Anyway, what's really interesting is that they have a thriving comic book industry. And the biggest comic book publisher in Africa is Comic Republic, and they're based in Lagos, Nigeria. We're actually partnering with them. The challenges, I think, are, in many cases, accessing audience. So what Comic Republic has done really well is they've gone digital, and they reached the diaspora. So 1 in 5 people in the diaspora, 1 in 5 Africans in the diaspora are of Nigerian heritage. So they play very strongly on that global audience, and they've been able to build a thriving business on that. What they then do is they place adverts into those digital comic books, which then make those comic books self-sustaining, but then they also allow people to purchase printed copies. So I think what the biggest challenge in Africa is really the business model, and distribution. It's been able to actually reach market and access the marketplace. And in many cases, we don't do that because we need to reach a critical mass, and that ultimately means, because animation is so expensive, that we have to do it across multiple countries. So we have to work with multiple broadcasters, multiple retailers. It's not impossible, and there's a great example of a South African comic book that ended up being a Disney syndicated and distributed series, and that's Super Strikers. That started off as a comic strip in the newspaper in 2006. Then South Africa won the World Cup 2010 World Cup bid, and they managed to raise some finance, and they turned it into an insert into the newspapers. They apparently have the biggest comic book distribution run in the world, and they reach 1 million people per month in Africa. So just to kind of bring it back to the question and to answer it simply, it's about distribution and the business model to access audience. And I think, in my opinion, that everything else kind of sorts itself out from that point onwards. We've got all these creative communities across the continent that are incredibly skilled. We just haven't found a working model for us to access the audience to be able to make it sustainable.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jacqueline. I'm from Durban. Very nice to meet Pamela, Nick, and Lydia. I had a question to Lydia specifically. You talked about using the motion sensors to then record dances, cultural dances. Like, what is your intention? How are you going to use that? Are you just kind of archiving things, or what's the ultimate game plan? And then I also wanted to know whether you use, like, the way you make money, is it through government advertorials mainly? Okay. Because you guys have been talking about distribution platforms, so are you on like TV, like traditional TV or stream or elsewhere? Thanks.
Okay. To answer your first question, that motion capture data is for Careers Adventure. Careers Adventure is now just Studios' first intellectual property that we hope to profit from. Its premise is, on the night of the spirits, a young girl goes off on a quest to reunite with her deceased father because he comes back as a ghost. But on her way there, she must use the power of traditional African dances to protect herself from the evil undead that are roaming the savannah. So that's actually what we are using the data for. Baganda is for it's a govi. It's a game and a movie. Baganda is for defense. Eskista, Ethiopia, is for flight. The Taraburu itself is for attack because it's a vicious, very vigorous dance. And government editorials are a portion of our company docket. I'd say a majority of it is ad revenue. We develop a lot of adverts. Usually we are the go-to people. I consider ourselves like one of the 5 go-to studios if you want animated content on your screens in Kenya. So it's usually advert work, edutainment, creating hybrid learning programs for cognitive function, for cognitive learning in schools. Editorials is, editorial bits, we've had maybe 3 contracts, and it's usually just during serious times in political scenes, elections, referendums, that type of thing. So, yeah.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. With that, we need to conclude today's panel discussion. It's been great. Thank you very much, Lydia, Pamelo, and to our great audience. Thank you for having us. Bye-bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will break for lunch, and after the break, we'll be talking about monetizing visual art. Enjoy your break. We'll see you in a bit.
Ubumo nuya kulala, uzopato kompo tujeju. Samora Machel has won. to those who have given their lives. Praises to thee, husbands and wives, all thy children shall reap what you've sown. This continent is home. My brothers and sisters, stand up and sing. Eduardo Montani is not gone. Frelimo, Frelimo, your eternal flame has shown us the light of dawn. Mozambique,
double.